So just over a minute to the start, and what's the state of play with the wind and the tide, Corky?
So still that breeze on that marginal lightish side. We're seeing 7.5, 8 knots, creeping up to 9 knots, but still fairly patchy, tucked up underneath these buildings again. The tide's still going to be a big factor, pushing them over the line and pushing them up onto those ley lines. So we're going to see them played at an advantage to the starboard end. That is a committee boat bias line, so you'll see more of them starting to hug that area of it. But it'll be interesting in with the last 40 seconds here how aggressive those British boats are going to be towards that Hungarian boat, and whether they're going to get involved with each other or whether they're going to try and sail their race and then attack when they're somewhere in the course.
Ben Cornish, wearing the blue jersey, telling us that he's currently in silver medal position. Can he improve on that today and take the gold away from Zsombor Barrett? Just coming into the final 10 seconds before the start. These are the nervous moments. These are the tense moments. Let's hear the count in. And that's the start. Individual recall. We wait to find out who it is that needs to turn back. There's quite
a few
going back.
It might have been Ed Wright at that starboard end.
And Zsombor Barrett, the yellow jersey wearer, has also gone back. That's disastrous for him. So two of the leading contenders having to go back. This is really going to open it up for others to have a pop at the medals.
It was interesting off that start there. Ben Cornish sat back a little bit late on that start and accelerated off reasonably late. He's taken an early tack out towards that right-hand side, but it's played totally into his hands now with the Hungarian and also fellow teammate Ed Wright having to go back. We see there from the graphic right above now, we've got Ben Cornish sat in this sort of second back area here, fighting his way out. He was a little bit back from that line, but you can see from this end of the start line that bias on that committee boat end favouring those boats coming off that right-hand side. So still plenty of racing to go, but certainly a great start from him.
Great start from him, and surprising errors from Zsombor Barrett and Ed Wright, but there's not a lot of room on that start line, and you do need to push for every meter that you can off the start line, and maybe it's a time on distance judgment with the current pushing them over the start line.
I'm sure it was a bit of that, and also it was very starboard bias, and so when if you've got a starboard bias line, it means that you sort of eat up that ground on starboard really quickly. It closes your angle down, you know. So suddenly, rather than being at 45 degrees to the line, if it was a square, you're suddenly, you know, got that starboard bias, and it means that you don't have as much space as you thought you had.
Nicholas Heiner currently leading this race, the Dutch sailor who made a recent switch from the laser to the fin. Now, he won the Laser World Championships in Santander in 2014, 3 years ago, and he's made a very quick and successful switch into the heavyweight men's class. And I wonder if part of that is because his dad, Roy Heiner, won a bronze medal back in, I think, 1996. So he's got fin blood in the genes. And it seems like passing down that knowledge is part of success in the fin, isn't it? Because there's a long line of success of British gold medal winners in the fin in the Olympics, dating back to Ian Percy, Sydney 2000. I think Great Britain has won every gold medal at the Olympics in the fin ever since that, mostly thanks to Ben Ainslie, also more recently thanks to Giles Scott last year.
Yeah, so since Ian in 2000, we've won every gold medal in the fin, and you know, it's very sort of a proud fact for us as British, and one that, you know, we obviously long want to continue. And I think because of, you know, those role models we've had in the fin, it's always meant we've got a really strong fin fleet. So, you know, Ben did 4 games in the fin, but there was always, you know, a pack of fin guys ready to take his place if he hadn't of been selected or, you know, dropped out of the process for whatever reason. One of those guys has been Ed Wright. You know, he's been in our British program for a long time, first in the laser and more recently in the fin, and he's won a world championship. He's come top three in the worlds, you know, a lot of times, and as yet, you know, he's still waiting to get an Olympic appearance.
Yeah, and the competition will remain as strong as ever. We wait to see if Giles Scott will return and see if he can qualify again for Great Britain for Tokyo 2020, having dominated the previous 4 years leading up to Rio 2016. And America's Cup, Corky, we gave a lot of love to the 49er yesterday and some of the helmsmen that we see in the America's Cup in Bermuda, but it seems like Finn sailors become skippers when they skippers of America's Cup teams.
Well, as I say, it's a combination of skills and that applied within the Finn class. So the Laser class is one of the most tactical sort of boats, being that one design, being down to a very physical element and the tactics applied. Well, the Finn's just that bigger step up. It's the bigger version of that Laser, and for a lot of Laser sailors, they take that natural progression into the Finn. So it's a very hard-fought boat, and so the skills and tactics that you can apply from that come across very good. And in the same sense as Sir Ben Ainslie, he's brought that skills into his boat. The one thing that he's now having to transition, and he says that is always a tricky side, is working within a team. It's always been down to him a lot more on the boat, an individual to make those calls, now using that information. But with Giles Scott, a fellow Finn sailor, alongside him as well, it's about bringing all of those skills and that information they can put into it and apply it to the team.
And Ian Percy, skipper of Artemis Racing, and Dean Barker, skipper of SoftBank Team Japan. So some good Finn talent that's progressed into the America's Cup. Let's come back to this race and the way the medals are switching around. I noticed that one of them that is getting a sniff of a medal right now is Dennis Karpak from Estonia. Occasionally we're seeing that bronze medal click up for him, depending on how the ebb and the flow of this first leg of the race is going. And it really comes back to that start and the error that Zombor Beretz and Ed Wright made. They really opened it up to some of the other boats just behind them to have a pop at the medals.
Well, this was the interesting thing, is that with the error made, there was actually the error made also from Ben Cornish's part as well. He was sat back a long way on the line, so he was clear and not involved with that, but then wasn't able to capitalize on those mistakes from it. And so we see him drawn right back into that group and in the snapping distance of those other boats. So it's still very, very hard fought, but they will all at the moment be fighting out in those bottom few spots, which are going to gain them big points and open up the opportunity for the Estonian sailor to climb onto that podium.
The Dutch sailor going from right to left across our screen, Ned 89, that's Nicholas Heiner in the lead, and got pretty good boat speed, certainly by the standards of the Finn, which is not a particularly fast boat. He's clicking at just over 5 knots, and everybody else is just under 5 knots or even worse. So the leader seems to be making good ground over the rest of the fleet right now.
I think Nicholas wasn't the Dutch boat that got selected in the Laser for Rio 2016. So he made the call to switch to the Finn. And I think he spent the winter down in Australia and New Zealand, taking benefit of the summer down there to really sort of step into the fleet this year, into the racing season this year, with a chance to actually race it, rather than just sort of at the back learning how to sail a Finn.
Now, they have the Oscar flag or something similar in this fleet, is that correct?
Yeah, in the 470 it goes up at 8 knots. I think in the Finn it doesn't go up till 12 or 14, so I'm pretty confident it's not up.
So you can really see the difference in the Finn when that flag comes down, can't you? Because it's a very, very physical boat downwind, but doesn't look like Nicholas Heiner is putting that much physical effort into the boat going downwind. So at the moment they are not able to use kinetics.
So they'll be in the same situation as the Lasers in terms of where, with the jury, if the jury will be watching, and if they're rocking around too much, the wind has dropped right off, so it's gone quite light again. If they're rocking around too much, the jury might come and have a closer look.
Well, Nicholas Heiner, at the moment with a 60-metre lead, he doesn't need to be taking any of those kind of risks. He's got a pretty healthy jump on the rest of the fleet. Having said that, if the fleet spread out side to side, we've seen plenty of place changes going on in the other four medal races today on these downwind legs, so it can be quite hard to defend. So a little slow-mo of Nicholas Heiner sailing the boat really flat. And Saskia, that's always the sign of a good sailor, when a boat is sailed so consistently flat. Why is it important?
Just sailing it smooth. Whatever you want to do, if you want to have a bit of heel on, or maybe a bit of windward heel or flat, it's just really important to have it smooth, so you're not rolling around from each one, and just have a really settled mainsail, so you're just keeping that flow attached to it, not disturbing the air on the mainsail, and that's a fast setup.
And as I was saying, sail a flat boat, there was a very heeled image there. But there are times to heel the boat over as well through manoeuvres.
Yeah, so when you go through the tack, you want to get that roll on. And that's so you can pull it down on the exit of the tack. And that's, you know, we've spoken about it a lot. That's what gives you a squirt forward as the mast accelerates through the wind and the wind accelerates off the back of the sail.
Just having a look over his shoulder, just getting a look at where the best breeze is and also where his competitors are aiming. So looking forwards, looking up at his sail, making some adjustments with his left hand, and then back to trimming that mainsail very accurately, and just allowing a little bit of roll to come into the boat, but not so much that it's going to attract the attention of the international jury. What he doesn't want is a penalty turn.
So as Nicholas Heine goes into a jibe there, I'm going to draw your attention to the mini map in the bottom corner. You can see the fleet laid out, but the front three boats are highlighted in orange or yellow, how it's perceived on the screen. You can see where they're positioned, but you can see how close the jury get to see what's going on. They're looking for, again, we talked about that leech. They're looking for this back part of the sail, how much it's flicking around. And so just focusing on this, you can see Nicholas move his weight in and then bring the boat back over towards him on the windward side. And it allows that sail just to continue to drive power off it, continually looking back, looking for that breeze and looking for that shift. So little movement of the breeze round towards that right hand side. And that's why the fleet all going for that jibe, a nice defensive jibe from Nicholas, to cover the fleet back in towards the gate mark. The gate marks this time being skewed over towards the other side and that right-hand side having the bias.
And it's very, very close on points at the moment between the top three, but we hear that there is a penalty for rocking imposed on Norway 1. So that's Anders Pedersen, who's had some good moments this season. He's not having a great time in Santander. He has just made the medal race, but lying in 10th place, and it's not getting any better for him, having been the first to be given a penalty for Rule 42 infringements, the kinetic infringements we've been talking about all afternoon. But, so he may not be the last. That could be a determining factor in this race. There's so little to choose between the top three. The medals could go anyway to Ben Cornish, Ed Wright and Zombor Barretts, and we can see the ebb and flow of the gold, silver and bronze moving between those three as they move down this run.
Well, very interesting. This breeze going even lighter now, so it's going to be really important to keep their momentum up and the pace up, but also with the changes in the breeze, that making the breeze go around a little bit more, got a bit more south in it now as well, so it's more southwesterly. So the race committee looking to change that course round slightly. Still the bias remains with the left-hand mark as the sailors look at it coming down, or as we look at it over the top. A nice big lead over the front of the fleet from Nicholas Heine. So the course has been changed and moved round towards that right-hand side. And so a nice, comfortable lead for Nicholas Heine to be able to take advantage of that with the bias on that left-hand gate mark, or the right as we look down upon it. You'll see that as we're on board with Ben Cornish making his move back through the fleet.
As we saw with the lasers, they tend to bring the mast over on top of them to reduce the wetted surface area of the boat in the water. That's Nicholas Heine safely around the bottom mark. And we've seen lots of place changes on those runs down to the bottom of the course, but not on this occasion for Ned 89, who sailed a very, very solid run and has actually maintained that same 50, 60-meter lead over the leaders, over the rest of the pack. But it's Alex Muscat from Spain who now sits in second place. And place is still changing by the moment behind them. So in the pack, there's an awful lot yet to go on.
There's a real race going on behind the Dutch guy between Ben, the Hungarian guy, and Ed. It's often there on the tying on points, and then it just sort of, someone gets a puff or an overlap, and it all sort of falls out and one of them is in the lead.
And that's exactly what we've seen at that gate, Mark. You can see the jostling right, trying to get round that left-hand mark. We see Ben Cornish leading Ed Wright out. But then also the Hungarian having to take quite an aggressive move out, being the door shut on him from the Australian sailor. So you saw him aggressively head up and stall the boat a bit to then give him position around that mark and tacking straight after the mark to clear his air. But all three of the medal contenders neck and neck as they go round that bottom gate mark.
And all of the medal contenders went round the right-hand mark, is that correct?
That's correct.
So GBR 91, that's Ben Cornish. That's one of the ones we're interested in. The other one, GBR 11, Ed Wright. These are the two Brits that should get a medal of some colour today. It's just a matter of who's going to get what. At the moment, it looks like Ben Cornish has the edge over Ed Wright in this particular race. And he went into the race wearing the blue jersey. So Ben Cornish marginally has the edge over Ed Wright. But how is Zsombor Barecz getting on? That's what we also want to know.
Ben's got a nice little position on them there as well. They've all sort of tacked onto starboard. And Ben's sort of managed to go with them, extended on Ed. So Ed's no threat to him at the moment. But he's also pretty sort of parallel with the Hungarian. So the Hungarian hasn't managed to sort of dig into that left-hand side and then he might be able to get a left shift and advantage from that. Ben has kind of matched him on that. So it's looking good for Ben Cornish right now.
Sailing on starboard tack with Ed Wright just behind him, GBR 11, with the red dot on his sail, telling us that he went into the day and bronze medal position. Looks like Norway 1 is doing quite well further to the shore side of them. Ben Cornish just about, he's thinking about attack. What's he actually doing? That was quite a big maneuver. Maybe thinking about attack and then thinking better of it, but now he does tack.
No, so just draw attention to exactly that. Just then, the Hungarian boat was coming across. Ben was putting a covering tack straight on top of him, but as he was going into his tack, the Hungarian started to go into attack, so he stalled the tack and went back out of it. Likewise, so there's a race going on for all three places, but Ben Cornish being very focused on the Hungarian sailor here and still trying to drive him through to claim his gold medal. So he needs to force him back down through the pack. He's got a couple of points breathing space on Ed Wright, so he needs to really focus on that Hungarian. And so some big sort of match racing tactics going on in the middle of the fleet.
So that's a difficult situation for Ben Cornish to manage. How do you think he's managing so far, Saskia?
He looks maybe a little bit too focused on the Hungarian. It's not a straightforward who beats who with those two. Ben needs to get two boats between him and the Hungarian. He sort of needs to... The fleet momentum is on port going right at the moment, and Ben and the Hungarian... Ben's just tacked now, going with them.
Is there a danger that they could forget about Ed Wright and maybe Ed Wright take the gold from both of them?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, Ed tacked back towards the centre of the course, and at the moment, these two guys are slightly on the... Well, there's three of them, isn't there? But these two are the ones we're interested in. Are quite hard left with the pack of the fleet all being quite central. And, in this shifty kind of stuff, it's really nice to be central. It means you can sort of take all the opportunities that come your way.
Well, Zsombor Barecz is who we're watching there. He has the yellow dot and the yellow jersey as the leader going into today. He was looking to take care of the British and put some dirty wind on them, but that's what Ben Cornish is doing to him at the moment, imposing some match racing tactics on the Hungarian. You can see how hard that Hungarian is working, putting his left arm behind his head for extra leverage. So the Finns are now operating at full power. Saskia, you don't often see that, do you, in a single-handed boat, someone using their extra arm out behind them?
Yeah, you see it in the ladies quite a lot. I think sort of important at the moment, they're in a big left-hand shift. And this guy is quite far left, and it's all about his speed right now to get across the fleet. He needs to, to do that, he's, maximum leverage, so an arm out. It's a speed game for him right now because he's pretty much on that port lay.
And now it's got softer, he's having to sit in a bit.
Well, it was interesting, just as you were saying, speed gain there. We saw the Hungarian speed go up to about 5.5 knots, sort of upwind, when Ben Cornish was sitting at just over 4. So there was a big gain, and that's where we're seeing as we're coming into this mark now. It's going to be very, very tight. When the camera pans out a little bit and we're drawn into that mark, we can see the blue jersey of Ben Cornish just to leeward, but a little bit in front of the gold jersey of the Hungarian boat as they come in. But it is also Ed Wright that they cannot forget about, who's that boat crossing in front of Ben Cornish now with the red dot on its sail. So this is Ed Wright coming across from the starboard side. And so these are your medal leaders here. A little bit of a mistake from the Hungarian then and just dropping that main sheet. All of these things are going to add up. But at the moment, how it stands, it'll leave the points very, very tight and not playing into Ben Cornish's hands at the moment. So with this rundown wind at the moment, the advantage is in the British boat of Ed Wright, GBR 11.
I can't sort of help thinking, particularly between the two British guys, is they've been defending something here. And, you know, they're some of the fastest guys in the fleet, but they're scrapping it out with 7th and 8th because they're defending something. And if they'd sort of just got their heads out a bit more and attacked the race a bit more, they might have just won the race and, you know, they wouldn't be having this scrap 7th to 7th, 8th and 9th.
Especially with the wind as patchy and as shifty as it is, maybe they should have looked at climbing up those ladders. And there are lots of opportunities on this race course. So you think maybe they've missed them by being too focused on the other man?
Yeah, I mean, just sort of particularly Ben on that upwind, he had lovely position. He was in control of it all. You know, Ed was sort of tucked up behind him on his windward hip, and the Hungarian was through his window and parallel with him. And he looked like he had all the cards at that point. And then as they sort of tracked back to the centre of the course, sort of Ben suddenly had decisions to make on who he followed, Ed or the Hungarian guy, Zombor. And from that point on, he just seemed to drop through the fleet and sort of missed a trick on the pack.
So in front of picture is Dennis Karpak, who at times has had a sniff of a medal in this medal race, but at the moment it doesn't look like it's going to go the way of Estonia. We look at the medals there at the moment and it's flicking around all over the place, because that's how close it is between these three, between Ed Wright and Ben Cornish of Great Britain and Zombor Barecz, who came into the day, the Hungarian with the yellow jersey. Which way is it going to go? So much of it comes down to what's going to happen on this final run.
It does, yeah, and we've still got big place changes here. Ed's just gone from the gold medal position, slipped down to the bronze medal position right now.
It's really patchy out on the water. We're seeing big ranges from anything to 6 to 9 knots, so radical speed differences from the boat. This, from our wind data, our predicted course is definitely the one that Ben Cornish is on. Shorter, faster, a greater breeze down that middle bit, and we're seeing he's adding a lot more distance here. So you can see this was Ed Wright with the breeze going slightly lighter. But this direction down through the centre of the course that Ben Cornish has actually been sailing has been the shorter and more dynamic way of getting downwind. But say for Nicholas Heiner, he's way clear out the front, looking very comfortable. But it is now, you can see the three medal positions still fighting it out at the top. It's very, very tight. Ed Wright slipping down to third, Hungarian up second, and Ben Cornish squeezing back up to first at the moment with how they stand. We're still coming down into this bottom third of this downwind leg. This is where it's going to tighten up. Only one mark to worry about as they go. A starboard bias on that finish line, so it's not over until they've crossed that line, and it's going to tighten up. And this is where suddenly the effect from other boats will affect Ben Cornish as he comes back across the group. We see him taking that jibe now, cutting him back. But look at Ed Wright, really suffering from that inside line, that breeze dropping out and really struggling, and has lost out to that outer line, that Ben Cornish. But looking at, looks like Ben Cornish has been whistled. There is a turn happening on board. We've just watched. We're waiting for the full confirmation of that. But if that's the case, it will have potentially handed the gold medal position to the Hungarian at the moment.
I mean, just looking at the speed stats down that run when Ben made that gain, there was a 2-knot difference on his side of the course, on the right-hand side of the course as you look downwind, he was 2 knots faster than Ed at a point there. So that's how he's made that gain around the pack. I think maybe he just got a bit bit excited with it as he's trying to get, you know, sort of desperately trying to cash that gain in and get back across the front of the pack. He sort of got blown up for a penalty.
Well, he's still squeezed in front of Ed Wright at the moment, but both British boats have been passed by the Hungarian. You can see the aggressive tactics now coming on from Ben Cornish, applying that instant simultaneous jibe on top of the Hungarian, trying to force a mistake as they come down into this gate. But it is just got to be a jibe around this gate and a reach down towards that finish line. Ben Cornish jibing early there. We can see in the background with the blue jersey on. So very, very tight.
So what's the Hungarian doing?
Hungarian's been doing a penalty turn as well. So this will turn it all on its head again. It's been handed to Ben Cornish as he's come round that leeward gate. Ben Cornish leading in through this position. Will he have done enough? Currently our points will put him at the top of the table. You can see Henry Weatherall, the other British boat, in between Ed Wright and Ben Cornish, joining the party. So the three British boats all fighting it out for themselves. But with that penalty, see, we see the penalty being applied. And again, that's what's changing all these places, right to the wire.
It's really hard to keep your composure when you're converging on that gate. And, you know, it's a metre or a centimetre will get that cross of the bunch, and you know, crossing that bunch would be the difference between first and seventh. It could be with all the overlaps and how it works, and you know, you can so easily just pump your sail and you suddenly freeze because you've realised you've done it, and the jury are there to pop you up.
So just moments from the finish line and it's all still so close, but it looks like Ben Cornish might have done just enough to take the gold medal. Could it be Ben Cornish who becomes the champion ahead of Zsombor Berec from Hungary? It's so, so close, but if things stand as they are, Cornish will take the gold medal.
Zsombor's gone quite high on this reach and Ed's gone quite low, so he still is mounting an attack. So we've got Henry Weatherall behind Ben Cornish.
And it's critical for Ben Cornish that Henry Weatherall manages to stay there and keep Barrett's behind him.
I think it's critical that Ed is in there as well.
And so close. Cornish is just about to cross the line.
Where is Ed Wright? If the Hungarian has overtaken him, I think that gives the gold medal to the Hungarian.
Well, it's so, so close. We're not going to call it quite yet, but it's really tight between Cornish and Barrett's, with Ed Wright looking like he's going to have to settle for the bronze medal.
But from the onboard camera there, it looks like a little nod from coach to let him know that he was one. There was a bit of a fist pump and a thumbs up. There's coach Matt Howard coming alongside. The smiles on board, I think, more of a relief before the celebrations really kick in. I think, yeah, the heart rate's got to slowly lower before he's able to properly put anything into picture. But what an amazing race, but a superb finish for the young British guy, Ben Cornish, who's really sort of driving and laying his impact and his name in the Finn class.
So, so dramatic. And the strange thing was, Ed Wright, I think he was the only one out of the top three that didn't take a penalty turn down that final run, but he chose the wrong side of the run. So it was better to choose the correct side of the run, but be caught out by the jury for a penalty turn.
Yeah, it was. I mean, the difference a few knots makes is huge in terms of distance you can travel. You know, they're big, heavy boats, the Finns, so any increase in wind, that's what you want.
And I think
they were probably fair and square, the penalties, to be honest. Definitely, you know, that one, the pack were right behind him, adrenaline's pumping, and he was just a bit too aggressive and got done. And we didn't see Cornish's one, but I'd sort of hazard a guess it was a bit similar, you know.
There was a lot of jibing going on, which didn't necessarily seem like they needed to be jibing. I wondered if they were just jibing for the sake of getting a bit of extra speed out of the manoeuvre.
Yeah. So one of the penalties that Nicholas Heiner got on the first lap was for rocking, not for pumping. And a way you can disguise your rocking is to put a jibe in it. So that's a call that the jury, you know, they watch it. And if they think that you're actually just rocking your way downwind, you'll get blown up for that.
Well, let's have a word with Ben Cornish. We believe that we might be able to have a word with the new gold medalist. And let's see what he has to say and if he can quite believe what he's managed to do. Ben, congratulations. When did you know? When you crossed the line, did you know that you won the gold medal?
You know, I was still sceptical because obviously there was a recall flag at the start. And we were certainly all close with the tide pushing over the line. So, you know, until I got the thumbs up from Matt, I wasn't certain. But, yeah, it's a nice feeling now.
Well, that final run to the finish, what were your thoughts as you went round the top mark? Ed Wright had got ahead of you. Did you wonder if you'd been focusing a little bit too much on Zombor and not enough on Ed?
There was a point in the middle of the second beat where me and Zombie did a couple of fake tacks, and I just gave Ed those boat lengths that he needed to get in front on the starboard lay line. In hindsight, I should have kind of stuck to both of them, but obviously that's easier said than done.
And then you got that penalty down the final run. Did you think that was it? Did you think you were done and the gold medal was gone at that point?
You know, you've just got to keep fighting in this sort of stuff. We raced here the other day and the place has changed all the way up until the finish line, so you've just got to keep racing. And, you know, the penalty that I got then got passed on to Zombie for, I think, a similar offence, so you can never give up until you're over the line.
Well, you are now World Cup Series champion here in Santander. How does this rate in your career so far?
Yeah, it's a nice way to get to the halfway point of the season. Obviously, started in Miami this year with a silver medal and then a bronze at the Europeans a couple of weeks ago. So I said there's one left to get, and it's nice to get my first international win. So I'm pleased with that.
Fantastic. Congratulations, Ben.
Thanks very much.
So, happy man who just about managed to clinch it, and what a way to finish the day, guys.
Yeah, that was a great race. Tense to the end, and they were all really fighting. And, you know, just really, like as Ben said, it is never over until you get across that line.
And who do you think would be the most disappointed out of those three? I mean, Ed Wright, perhaps. It looked like he'd done the right things in that race until the final run, and he just got caught out by the wrong side of the final run.
Yeah, he will be gutted, but, you know, it's close, and it just kept swinging back both ways, both on the upwind on the shift and on the downwind with the pressure. So you sort of, you know, if you get some easy wins, and, you know, sometimes you're winning a race because you jagged it out to a side and it's an easy win in conditions, and you can lose it just as quickly. So you have to sort of, you know, take the rough with the smooth.
Well, let's see how it worked out on the overall leaderboard at the end of that. So Ben Cornish finishing on equal points with Zombor Barrett, but because he did better in the medal race, it's Cornish who takes gold ahead of the Hungarian for silver, and Ed Wright having to settle for bronze. And Dennis Karpak not far behind, only 2 points behind Ed Wright, so nearly a medal for Estonia. And Nicholas Heiner, one to watch in this class, already made a fast transition into the fin from the laser. He's in fifth place. So, great way to finish our five medal races for the day. Corky, you've done a great job of analysing the key moments in these races today. Let's see if you can do it for the fin race.
Well, there was plenty going on in that race straight from the start, and that's where the action already happened. So we're going to join straight in on the start line. And what they seemed like a clear line was a straight off, the tide underneath them forcing them up. We see the individual recall flag go up early off that left-hand side, Ed Wright jibing round, and then the Hungarians on board jibing back as well. So two of the medal favourites taking that individual recall, getting back to restart that race and suddenly causing this whole race to flip on its head straight away, handing in the opportunity to Ben Cornish off that start. But again, not a wonderful start from Ben Cornish, being a little bit further back. We can see him there just second left of picture in the blue bib, working out towards that right hand side. But then the action continued. We carried on up the upwind and then back down to this Leeward gate where we saw the split. And we see Ben Cornish leading that pack out from that left-hand side again, tucked on his heels, Ed Wright, and right behind them, the Hungarian, just going into attack there, Zomborg. So really pushing those elements, but showed how close that racing was. And again, Ben Cornish picked up on it in his interview about that. He got a little bit focused and started throwing in some match racing. And so we saw a little tacking duel go on in the middle of the course. So Ben Cornish here, GBR 91, looking to go into a bit of attack. He thinks about it. But then he stops and bails back out of it. And then when we pan out, you can see the Hungarian now take attack. Then Cornish takes another attack. And they're just trying to split. So they got a little bit focused. That gave the opportunity to Ed Wright to be able to get out of that right-hand side. But it went all the way to the last gate before it all finished up. A penalty first was handed to Ben Cornish, but that was the defining moment where another penalty got handed back to Zomborg, the Hungarian here, which there you enabled the three British boats to squeeze past up that gate mark. Very tight, Zomborg alongside Ed Wright, but that's where it handed it to Ben Cornish. So even though his opportunity to make that gain, he slipped up. He had a penalty, and then there was one thrown back at the Hungarian. So, as Ben Cornish well described, it's not over until it's over. So, those are the speed and distance and manoeuvres that happened out on that race course. Some of those manoeuvres, obviously, from Ben Cornish and Zomba, the Hungarian, would be the manoeuvres. The extra manoeuvres there will be those impacts of that penalty turns as well. So, that's why they're sailing slightly higher. But Nicholas Heiner, a fine race to finish off his event here as well.